Greetings, humans. You have entered the Command Zone, your destination for all aspects of Elder Dragon Highlander. Enjoy your stay.
Greetings, everybody. You are listening to another episode of the Command Zone. I'm Jimmy Wong with my co-host,
Josh Lee Kwai. What up, what up?
How's it going, everybody? So we have a great show for you guys today. We've got a commander spotlight on Rafiq of the Many, and we also have a main topic of which Josh brilliantly came up with, which is how to teach Magic the Gathering to someone, because it's a very important skill.
Yeah, it's something that, you know, over the years I've had a chance to do many times. In fact, recently I was teaching one of my nephews who's 14 years old how to play Magic. You know, it's super rewarding. You know, Magic's been a really good companion and friend to me over the years, and so it's really a gift you can give somebody. And also, like, it grows your play group. It helps the game itself stay strong. It gives you somebody else to play against. You know, all good things, all things you want to do. And I know, Jimmy, you know, you've taught a lot of people to play, you know, a lot of different games over the years. You know, I have too. So I know it's daunting. It's a really daunting task because Magic is a super complicated game.
Yeah, and it's also a gift, like you said, that keeps on giving, because you teach someone, you know, to play one game or play a game like Magic, and I think it sometimes in a lot of people stirs up a thirst for this sort of competitive, cool, like new way of interacting with friends and stuff that is competitive but isn't necessarily friendship breaking, if that makes sense. And it's something that you can eventually it becomes sort of the thing where, like, now you're playing with other people that are at your skill level, and it just makes you a better player because they might bring something to the table that you never thought of.
Yeah, that's a really good point. Like, if you're looking to improve as a player, a good way to do it is just to have somebody strong that you're playing against. You know, there's this thing that they talk about the Williams sisters, Serena and Venus, in tennis, because they sort of came out of nowhere. They played in Compton. They came out of Compton. There's no great tennis players, you know, world-class tennis players that came out of there, but because they had each other, they were able to raise both their games to such a high level that they were able to dominate tennis for all those years.
And oh, wow.
Yeah, and so having a strong person to just compete against on a consistent basis is a good way for you to just continue to get better at the game. So, you know, and you know, one other thing I would say about teaching is, like, it's amazing when you're teaching anything how much you as the teacher learn.
Oh, yeah, definitely. I would just say that, like, relearning the basics to anything is so important, because even just taking a step back and being like, wow, I kind of just sort of skip the untap, upkeep, draw phase when I play, because it's sort of always just implied. But teaching someone else, you realize that, like, there are triggers there. There's a lot more interactions to be allowed in those certain points.
Yeah, there's a lot of things you know you should do, but you sort of shortcut them sometimes. And sometimes slowing down when you're teaching somebody just makes you realize the, you know, little leaks in your game. And also just looking at things from the different perspective sometimes makes you notice things that you never would have. Because, you know, like you said, some things are so habitual that, you know, you're not constantly examining them. And so you're not even realizing, like, little teeny things in your game, little leaks, you know, where you could be just, you know, eking out a little bit more advantage here and there. And so teaching somebody is a really good way to find that stuff. So, you know, having said all that, you know, the first thing you usually want to do when you're teaching somebody is build a couple of specific decks, you know, what I'd call teaching decks. And one of the important things when building the two decks that you're going to be facing off against is that, you know, they can be 40 cards, they can be 60 cards. You know, you want to stick to probably monocolored, at the most dual colored. You're trying to take complexity out as much as possible. You want to make them really creature heavy. You probably don't want any instants. You don't want, you know, artifacts, enchantments. You know, you probably want to stick to, like, creatures, mostly vanilla creatures, and sorcery speed stuff and simple things, you know. So, like, I would build a deck that's mostly, like, what we call Hill Giants and Grizzly Bears, which are, like, 2/2s and 3/3s, you know, and then maybe a couple of what we call French Vanilla creatures. And French Vanilla are just the basic keyword stuff, the simple stuff, like first Strike, Vigilance.
Flying.
Yeah, and have a few of those. And then, you know, anything with a ton of text on it, a ton of rules text, I just wouldn't put in there, for, you know, when you're first teaching somebody.
Yeah, and it's like, ultimately, like, you know, you as a teacher might be like, well, this is the most boring deck in the world to play, but as someone that's never played Magic before or has a limited experience playing, it's still going to be very complicated. And just the idea of trading power for toughness and et cetera, like, what beats what in combat and double blocking and all that. I mean, I think that sometimes you just declaring blockers is one of the most complex part of the games. So if you're able to just lessen the complexity there and make stuff easier for them to understand how to block effectively and how to trade effectively, et cetera, is really important.
Totally, totally. The other thing I would say, you know, we've got 10 rules we're going to go through, 10 rules for teaching, I call them. But one overall thing to keep in mind the whole time when you're teaching somebody, I just call it like keeping your perspective, which is basically means like stepping into your students' shoes, their eyeballs, their point of view, and looking at the game from the perspective of somebody who doesn't know anything about it. You know, when you're teaching, it's inherently an unselfish act. So you got to get outside of yourself and you have to like think like, if I don't know anything about the game, does what I just said just make sense? Or does it even matter? Is it relevant? Like those are things. So just constantly, as you're going through the process of teaching, just constantly be sort of changing your lens and looking at it from the student's perspective and trying to attack things from that angle. It'll make things a lot easier for them to digest.
Yeah, definitely. And as an example of this, anytime you play a video game, right, there's always a tutorial section in the beginning. The best video games have tutorials that don't even realize are tutorials until, you know, you learn how to play the game. Like all the Portal games, I think, are really a brilliant way of teaching you how to play the game while throwing you into the universe at the same time. And so, you know, you have to realize that game designers spend hours and months at a time developing just this section of the game because it really is integral to how a person perceives the game from that point out. And the bad tutorial or something that someone isn't enjoying as actively is going to really deter them from playing the game. And it's going to be the same when you learn to play Magic. I'm sure that everyone has their sort of negative experiences of either getting beaten or having someone throw a mechanic in their face that they didn't understand. And it's not a pleasant experience. And ultimately, like, sure, if you want to play Magic at a competitive level, you need to get to that point. But it's really important to know that when you're starting out, you need to prioritize, like Josh said, keep your perspective and know where you're teaching from and what's going to really help both you and your student.
Okay, awesome. Yeah, I totally agree with all that. So the rules for teaching somebody how to play Magic. Rule number one, show, don't tell. So what does this mean, Jimmy?
Well, this means that you need to basically, it's not like you're going to sit someone down with no cards on the table and sit there and talk about, all right, well, Magic the Gathering is a game where you have 40 cards, blah, 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 or 60. You essentially want to get cards in front of them, have them using cards in their hand, drawing cards, tapping lands, doing stuff, and basically have them do stuff. Show them how to do it. Don't just get really complicated and blast a ton of dialogue in their face. You know, make sure that they can see what they're doing affects other stuff so that when they tap mana, you know, they can understand that, okay, I can do this and play this essentially.
Yeah, exactly. So I literally like to start you and I not really say anything. It's just like, here's your deck. Here's my deck. Okay. To start a game of Magic, we both start with 20 life and we're going to try and get everybody down to zero to win. So yeah. Or we're going to try to get the opponent down to zero to win. So to start every game, we draw 7 cards. And then we just have each player draw the 7 cards and put them all face up on the table so everybody can see each other's hands. You know, and you explain that you don't normally do that, but for teaching purposes, you are. And then you literally go, okay, you can play one land each turn. These are lands. And this is how you tap lands and cast spells. And this is how the mana cost factors in.
Yeah.
And you just go... And as you go, you know, you let them tap their lands, you let them choose which spells to cast, and when things pop up as they normally would in the game, that's sort of how you explain it. But it's really important that the cards are in their hand, they're actually manipulating them, they're actually seeing the stuff. Because like you said, if I'm just spouting information at them before they've even got any context for what I'm talking about, it's useless.
Yeah, exactly. And the beautiful part about Magic is that it is a very simple game at its core with just a few rules to shape the world. And from there, it's really easy to have them be like, okay, you play one land a turn. You can tap it once to add a certain amount to your pool and then play a card in your hand. And you can essentially build the rules for them from the ground up. You know, yeah. So it's like this creature comes into play. All right, another rule about the game is that they have summoning sickness. And you sort of go from there, you know, so you don't start from the top down, you go from the bottom up. And I think that helps people construct the rules and how the game works in their head a lot more clearly.
So the second rule I call let them play. So what this means is, you know, I see this a lot. And this is when you're teaching anything. If you're teaching somebody something on the computer, if you're teaching them something and they're holding a pen and pencil, don't grab the stuff from them. You know, the tendency is like, I want to grab the mouse and I want to show you how to do it. That's not a good way to teach people, because the way that recall works in the brain is that it's reinforced if it's on multiple levels. So hearing something mm-hmm. is one level of recall. Writing something down, physically interacting with something, is another level of recall. If I do both of those, then now it's reinforced and it's a higher level than any one would be by itself. So if I'm telling you something and you're physically doing something, you're going to have a lot better chance to remember it. So what I want to do is I want to say, okay, so you're going to tap that forest to cast that mystic elf. Like, I don't reach over and tap the force, and I don't take the card out of your hand and put it onto the table. I just tell you what you need to do that. Because after you've done it a couple times, physically done it, then it's easier for you to remember to do that in the future.
Yeah. And in the same vein of things, you want to be asking them to write the questions when you're letting them play, right? So it's not just like, hey, you need to do this right now because this is the best play for you. You know, they have a card of... of seven cards in their hand, and they may not know what any of them do, but you can ask them the right question. So for example, okay, you have two lands out and you're going to want to look in your hand for any cards that you can tap your two lands in play, because that's the most efficient and cost-effective thing to do at this point. So let them look through their hand and have them ask you the right questions, and you can answer them. But like Josh said, you don't need to be playing for them. You essentially are playing for them, but... you don't want to make it seem like you are literally making all their decisions.
Exactly. So you want to read rule number three?
Yeah, rule number three, and I love this rule, is keep it simple. And if you want to add a word to that, stupid is my favorite. The KISS rule, which is basically just make the game as broken down as possible and easy as possible for them to learn from the beginning, which is why Josh said build a deck that doesn't have instants and combat tricks. And also, you know, keep away from planeswalkers. Think about sort of Portal and the first starter sets. You know, they have all the text on the cards. They explain what everything is, from flying to vigilance and first strike. And so basically you want to make it as broken down as possible. Don't even think about the stack. Stick to those vanilla creatures and simple combat. And for the first few games you play, this is more than enough for them to sort of get into their heads, especially if someone's not familiar with the card game and just card games in general.
Think about combat. Like, think about, I've got a 3-3 and a 2-2, and you have a 3-3 and a 1-1, and I attack with both my creatures. And you've never played the game before. Like, there's a lot of decisions right there. Well, I could block, I could trade, I could, you know, block and not trade, I could chump block one and kill the other. You know, there's so many decision points. And if you've never played the game before, that's super complicated. Now, that's really easy for enfranchised players, players that have played a lot, players like us, you know, but that's just four vanilla creatures, two on each side facing off. You know, so you don't want to be throwing stuff like giant growth in the mix there, because that totally changes things to the point where, like, until they have the basics down of just attacking and blocking with no other outside things possible, it's, you don't want to layer on another thing before they've got the basic thing down. So that's why I say stay away from combat tricks. You know, counter spells, another thing that's just like early on, it's just really confusing. It doesn't seem super fun. It's just like, I tried to do something and you just stopped it. You know, it's timing wise, just hard for them to figure out. That's why sorcery speed is just a lot safer, because you just want to be able to do one thing at a time. You don't want to start worrying about the stack, how effects stack up, that kind of stuff. It's just, it's really hard for a new player to grasp all that stuff.
Yeah, essentially Magic, how the game must have been designed from the very first moment, before a lot of like stuff like Mill and Dredge and all these other ideas that came in to make the game more complicated, of course, and more complex. But yeah, Magic, the game at its most broken down state. Now, instances were there in the beginning, but there's nothing more disheartening than telling someone then, okay, so the next thing you want to do is play this card, and then you play it, and then you go like, okay, I counter it. Like, that's not a very fun lesson to learn for anyone.
It's just not, early on, it's just not good.
Yeah, exactly.
Okay, so the next rule, rule number four, shut up. That's the rule. Teach the minimum amount. They don't need to learn the entire game all at once. You know, they just need to be excited to learn it. And you know, I see this a lot too. Another thing, when you see people teaching people anything, but especially when you see people teaching other people Magic, you know, they start to tell stories like, they'll be explaining to you something and it'll remind them of a good story about a magic game that they played, and they think that the new player's interested. You know, they'll be like, oh yeah, I once had this thing and I played this thing on it and the other guy tried to do this and blah, blah, blah. And to a new player, they don't have context for what any of the crap you're talking about is. Like, they don't know that those cards, even if they've seen it once, they don't have it memorized. They don't know what it does. They don't know how it interacts with other cards. And all you're doing is, like, their brain will naturally try to understand that stuff.
Mm-hmm.
So you're just like filling up their brain space with all this confusing stuff that they're going to try to digest. And it's just going to clog up the works and make it hard for them to learn the stuff that's actually important for them to learn right now, which is like, should I block or not?
Yeah.
Should I cast a creature or not? You know, that's the level that they're at. So
yeah,
this is
exactly.
Not about proving how smart you are. Like, get outside of yourself. It's not about other stories or anything else. It's just about them playing the game and understanding on a basic level how the game works. So do the minimum amount of talking that you have to get that done.
Yeah, exactly. And to relate a personal story, I remember when I was a kid going to my local game store to learn another card game. No one had taught me how to play. I just sort of had a very basic idea, and I wasn't looking for anyone to play. I wasn't in the situation where someone is actively teaching me, but I was excited to learn it.
Mm-hmm.
And actually hearing these stories in an outside context when someone wasn't teaching me was great, because I heard two people talking about the game they just played and working through their head, saying all the card names and not having to explain the text on them, and just the other player knowing exactly what the card was that they were talking about. And that made me really excited to learn it. But had that situation been someone trying to teach me the game and tell me these stories, it would not have had the same effect. So, you know, like, it's really easy to get someone excited about something if placed in the right context. And sometimes when you're teaching someone, that's not the right place to necessarily be dropping stories about your awesome card that you did this one time and you drafted this, et cetera, et cetera. And you saw these signals coming in or whatever. At that point, the player isn't necessarily interested in that. But if they're in a different situation, sure. It just really depends on the context.
Precisely. You want to read number 5?
Yeah. Okay, this is also, actually, all these rules are incredibly important. Rule number 5, though, is make it fun. So this is so important to teaching anything, because you're not going to want to play something if someone isn't teaching it to you and you're not enjoying it. It's like you're imagining, great, now I'm just back in my least favorite class in school.
Sure.
You know, you don't want to become your parents and scolding someone and teaching them a lesson when they make a mistake or something. You need to be encouraging. And it's not like you're going to be talking to someone like a baby or talking to them like they're a child, but you need to speak to them as an equal or a peer. And that's the important thing, is that by being encouraging, you are also making sure that they are doing their own decisions. They're making their own decisions, that they're being really active about what they do. And you are encouraging them to make their own choices with your guidance. You know, at the end of the day, you're trying to get them from the point where you make 100% of their decisions, which is draw 7 cards, that's how we start the game, to them drawing the cards, knowing what to mulligan, knowing what to play first with their cards. So you want to essentially cross that entire spectrum, and the best way is to be making it an enjoyable experience the entire way through.
Yeah, that's totally true. Like, if the first experience is not good, you know, there's just a really good chance they just never try it again. I mean, there's too much stuff in the world. There's movies,
yeah.
There's video games, there's other board games, there's card games, there's hiking outside, you know, there's basketball and baseball and all kinds of, like, in your life, there's a lot of choices for stuff to do that's fun. So if you've tried something once and it's just not that fun, why are you ever going to go back to it? You got a whole bunch of other stuff in the world you've never tried before that might be better than that.
Yeah, exactly. And another example I guess I'll bring up from real life is the reason I play League of Legends and still play League of Legends is because I have a fun group of friends that I can always party up with and to play with, and we can teach each other and sort of give each other strategy and help each other coordinate during the game. And one thing I found out is that a lot of times when I'm playing League by myself and a lot of people are yelling at me or being angry that I'm not doing something right.
Wait, that never happens in League of Legends. What are you talking about?
Yeah, that'll never happen. That never happens in that or Dota or any of those MOBAs or World of Warcraft when I wipe a raid or whatever.
Nobody gets
at that
upset.
Point,
what are you talking about?
Yeah, well, why would you ever get upset about something? Come on, guys. So like that, in those examples, but people get angry at me for losing or for helping or making them lose, essentially. They're blaming it on someone else. You get this different kind of inspiration that I think is really negatively impactful, whereas you feel awful for what you've done and you want to like play again just so you can do better and get the approval of your teammates. And, you know, and I think that's the absolute wrong way to go when you're playing a game, because you never want to have someone vying for something, like for someone's approval or for someone to say good job or whatever. You want to make sure that they're coming into the game from a positive standpoint, not from a where the cup is half full instead of half empty, etc.
Well, imagine like if you had first played League by yourself solo your very first game and everybody yelled at you for being a noob, you probably would have turned the game off and never come back, because you're not at the point yet where you understand it enough to even understand how to play better. You're just still learning. So, you know, negative experiences early on, they're just really bad. You know, you're just going to do the opposite of what you're trying to do, which is bring somebody to the game. You're actually going to make it so that they never want to play the game again. So, yeah, remember, the goal when teaching somebody is not winning. It's not you winning. It's not them winning. It's not about competition at all. That can be later, you know. But if you try to teach and be competitive, you're aiming at two targets. You'll miss both. I mean, it's just not possible. Just try to remember your goal. Your goal is to teach them the game. It's not to win. It's not for them to win. It's just understanding of how the game works.
Yeah, and first impressions really do matter in every aspect of life, whether it's the person that you met on the side of the road one day, or it's the first time you play a game, or it's the first, you know, first 2 minutes of an episode of TV that you like or don't like. You know, the first impression really sticks. And then psychologically, it's true. You can't really do much to actually help the impact of a first impression. So if you set a negative first impression, that is going to be something that is a mentality that is hard to break in someone. So make sure you set the right tone when you start, and that is about fun. And, you know, the best times you can play Magic, sure, you know, are when you're winning, but it's also when you have the most fun. Because some of my most memorable experiences are really close games that I may have lost, but had a blast playing.
Yep, that's very true, and it's a very good point. Okay, rule number 6, slow it down. This means you don't ever want to make the person you're teaching feel like they can't keep up or they're not keeping up. You want to make it easy for them to learn. You want to take away all judgment. You want to make them feel like they're very safe and unjudged. You know, you don't want to have a point where they sort of forget a rule that you taught them or something like that, and you make them feel bad about it. You know, you just want it to be like, don't worry, there's no pressure, you know? And when they break a rule, you know, if they forget that something has summoning sickness, you go and go, no, you have that has summoning sickness. I told you that, remember? No, you say, yeah, that's just not a good way to do it. You just go, oh, yeah, I'm sorry, I probably didn't explain that very well. You know, the first turn that something comes into play, it can't do anything. You know, that puts the onus on you as the teacher and takes it away from them as the student. And it makes it so much easier to learn something when you're not also simultaneously thinking about, like, does my teacher think I'm stupid? Do they, you know, am I keeping up? You know, how am I doing? How am I doing? You don't want your energy to be how am I doing energy. You want it to be what am I doing energy, you know, as a student. So
think about how many times that you've made a mistake in when you play Magic, and even after playing for years or months or, you know, however how long, going to play Magic online for the first time, I felt like the stupidest person in the world.
Because I would make Magic for a while.
And I know when triggers happen, but continually I would make mistakes. And that's when, you know, if you are a beginner, that's, you need to know as a teacher that everyone is allowed to make mistakes, and you'll let people have takebacks. When we play Commander competitively, even against our friends, we let each other have takebacks too, because it's like, oh, I just didn't realize that was on the board. Otherwise, I wouldn't have done that. You know, it's like a bunch of just, you want to take away the feeling of inadequacy that you have as a new player, that they might have, thinking that, like, oh, maybe I'm just not good enough to play this game or whatever. It's like, well, you know, like, this is maybe the second time you've ever played Magic. Let the mistakes flow, because you want to learn from mistakes. You don't want to have them shut you down.
And another thing, you know, that's really important, that's along these lines, is like, you as the teacher, like, fight those feelings of frustration, annoyance. You know, teaching is really a lot about patience. You know, it's about not judging the student. It's just about being very patient and very calm and just re-explaining things you've already explained. You know, it's just, that's how teaching works. Teaching anybody anything, they're not going to get everything you think they should get right away. You just explain it a couple more times until they do. You know, that's, and you just have to have this in mentality that, like, I'm just going to be very determined not to be frustrated, not to get annoyed, and just to be patient. You know, that's a game you can play with yourself every time you feel those feelings, because they're natural when you're teaching people stuff, because you know a whole bunch of stuff they don't, and it's really hard to be like, why aren't they getting this? It's okay. They will get it. Just keep being calm. Just keep explaining it.
Yeah, and think about some of your favorite teachers you've ever had, you know, in school, or some of your least favorite teachers, you know, like think actually back to why they were your favorite or why they weren't. And I can almost guarantee you that teachers that you didn't like were probably the ones that criticized the most, yeah, or weren't the encouraging ones, or weren't consistent with their message. And, you know, if there's one thing I've learned, I was just a camp counselor recently in Oregon, and shout out to all those guys over at Camp Recruiter. Yeah, Oregon. It's that, you need to be consistent with your message if you're trying to teach someone something. Because if someone is learning something for the first time and you knew learning it, it's the same sort of thing. Like Josh said earlier, you need to either write it down. It helps you learn one way hearing it orally. It's also doing it consistently helps a lot too. Just telling someone one thing one time and hoping they remember it forever isn't going to work. You need to be consistent with how you deliver your message, and that really helps grind in the tenets of what the rule is to that person.
Very true, very true.
All right, so rule number 7, keep it moving. This means that don't stop. You know, don't stop constantly. Don't like hit the pause button and be like, okay, so what happened here is what you did incorrectly or whatever. You know, you're analyzing. You don't want to just keep doing that, whatever, because it gets tedious. Don't stop something just to point out a mistake. You know, stop something to maybe say like, hey, good job with that play. You made a really good decision here based on what you had in your hand and what the board was like. But don't consistently stop to lecture or go into discussion. Strategy is for later.
Yeah, I think this specifically has to do with strategy discussion. Like, you know, let's say it's turn 3 and they have a choice between a couple of different creatures in their hand, and they play one instead of the other, and you think they should have played the other one. It doesn't matter. Like, don't stop and be like, why'd you play that grizzly bear instead of this guy? You know, because you're not at the level yet where they're even doing strategy. They're just trying to understand how the game works. So let them play their stuff, let them make their decisions, and let them make mistakes. And you don't have to point out mistakes, strategic mistakes. You know, if they attack with something that has summoning sickness, yeah, you have to let them know that, because otherwise they're gonna get the wrong view of how the game itself works. But if they attack with their creature and they shouldn't have, you know, they got a 3-3, you got a 4-4, and they just attack into you, just block it, kill it, you know. And if they go, oh man, I shouldn't have done that, which is what most people do, you'll go, yeah, and you know, next time you'll know. And that's okay. We're not trying to win the game, remember? We're just trying to have an understanding of the game. And that'll resonate so much more with them than if you just said, I wouldn't attack with my 3-3 right here because I got a 4-4. You know, if they just watch it get eaten one time, that's going to, you know, be a lesson that sticks in their head a lot more.
Yeah, a much more effective lesson too, because like making a mistake and learning from it is probably the most fundamental part of playing Magic better.
There's a great saying I like, and it says, it is a rare man indeed who can learn from another's mistake.
Ooh.
And it's true. Like if you think in life, it's just very hard to learn from somebody else's mistakes. You mostly have to learn from your own mistakes, you know? And so them making mistakes is not bad. Don't try to insulate them from mistakes that they're making strategically.
Yeah. You can still have fun and make mistakes. Yeah. I think making mistakes is part of the fun, in that you get excited to not make that mistake, you know, again.
And going back to the last point, you know, the slow it down point, or the not getting frustrated or annoyed or making them feel safe, you know, you start to get a little gun shy if every time you start to make a decision, the person across the table from you like questions it, you know, like, well, are you sure you want to do that? Like, maybe you should do this. Every time you try and tap your creature or tap land or cast something, you know, it's mostly like, just let me make my decisions, dude. Just let me try and play the game and have fun, you know, and then I'm not worried about whether you're judging my decisions or not, you know, because that hampers learning. If they're using any part of their brain function, worrying about, well, if I do something here, is he going to think that's the right move?
Yeah, exactly. If you're not really playing for someone else's judgment, if that makes sense. Yeah.
Okay, the next rule is teach with style. And by this, I don't mean have some sort of flamboyant way that you teach. I just mean, like, tailor your teaching style to your student. So, you know, people are different. Like some people, I've taught people the game of Magic and they weren't really getting it until I said, listen, we're both wizards and all these cards in our hands are spells and the lands are the power for the spells. And so now I'm attacking it from a flavor angle and a story angle. And all of a sudden, like in their mind, the game made more sense. You know, oh, I'm I'm summoning a creature to go and attack you because I'm a summoning wizard. But then I summon a fireball and I threw it at your creature. You know, that we're telling a story with the game. That made total sense to them. But I've taught people to play Magic who like the math and the logic of it were what got their mind really going, you know. And so you just have to sort of read your student and see what they're responding to and sort of come at the game from that angle for them sometimes.
Yeah, and this is also something that you as a teacher can make a mistake in. You could, as someone that is really interested in math and logic, start out and being like, okay, so here comes a card called the Runeclaw Bear, and a bear is essentially a middle-of-the-road creature. He's strong on power, and he's strong on toughness and defense, so he's a 2-2, and they may just not just get the flavor, and they may just not care about the name or the art and are only looking at the numbers on the bottom, mm-hmm. and that's totally fine. If you find that they're not resonating with a certain way you're saying something, just approach it from another angle the next time and see what triggers that light bulb that goes off in their head when you're explaining something, and follow the path that a student or someone gives you. Don't create your own path and hope it's just going to work for everyone. Let them teach you how to teach them.
Yeah, that's a really good point. I think other things to keep in mind is like, how old is the person you're teaching? You know, you're inherently going to have to teach a teenager differently than somebody who's in their 20s. You know, the math may be really hard if you're teaching like a 12 and 13 year old. Like, you know, you might build the decks so that the creatures are all like, their power and toughness are all the same, just because that makes the math a lot easier. You know, 2-3s and 3-4s are a lot harder to deal with math wise than 3-3s and 2-2s. So
yeah, definitely.
So that may be something to keep in mind. You know, what other games have they played? You know, do they play a lot of games in general? Like, gamers are gonna just catch up to certain things like a lot faster than people who don't play a lot of games, you know? Mm-hmm. So that's just things to keep in mind when you're teaching, is just tailor your style to your student.
Yeah, definitely. And especially if they are someone that has played a lot of other board games, it's great to bring in examples from other games that are similar, because there are a lot of games that have, you know, similar concepts and playing cards that help you play other cards, like cards like games like Dominion, stuff like that. So doing stuff like that helps explain a lot better. Also, like, hey, so this is just like in this game where you do this, but the difference here is that this is what happens or whatever, and that will really help you adjust your teaching accordingly.
Yep, that's a great point.
All right, rule number 9, which is we kind of discussed this a little bit earlier, but it's flip the script. So when you do pause the game, have them explain what's going on back to you. So if they're doing something, saying like, okay, so that creature attacks, can that creature attack? It's like, actually, no, that person can't attack. And you ask them, why not? Well, and they'll say, you know, they just played it and has summoning sickness. Can you tap this land to do that? Well, I can't, but I can tap these two forests and these two colorless because et cetera, et cetera. So you essentially want to have them ask the right questions, questions that you might ask on your turn that maybe intuitively you don't ask anymore. So for a tapping example, let's say you have 5 lands out and 2 of them are plains and the rest are forests. And you need 3 plains to cast something in your hand. Now, in your head, if you have a card that's 1 mana and 3 white, you're going to look at your board and be like, well, I can't cast this. I don't have the mana. But you wouldn't ask yourself that question. You would just look at the card and just know intuitively. But someone that's starting the game out would have to take that step to ask that question. So make sure that they're asking the same questions that you would in a game, and that's going to make sure that they also sort of interpret the game in the most strategic and correct way.
Yeah, I think you explained that rule. I have nothing to add. You explained it perfectly.
I'm perfect. Oh boy, I'm going to listen back to this someday and be like, oh gosh, that was no, so not
it was
perfect.
You hit every point. I think that was really awesome. Okay, rule number 10, quit while you're ahead.
So important.
Yeah, super important. You know, it's a really complex game. So you kind of got to get it out of your head that you're going to be able to teach anyone the game in one sitting. You know, you need to sort of read your student as you're teaching. Your goal is that they walk away and they're just marveling at the possibilities of the game. You know, you don't want them to be walking away and they're just struggling under the weight of like a ton of information. You know, you don't want to info dump them to the point where they're just, their brains just, you know, they got a headache and it's just so much, it feels like they can't hold all that information. So
yeah.
So you really got to pay attention. If they seem to start getting frustrated, you know, take a break, walk away, say, okay, that's great. You know, we'll play again tomorrow. We'll play again in an hour, or we'll play again later, whatever it is.
Yep.
Don't, you know, you can overstay your welcome really easily when you're teaching stuff.
Yeah, exactly. And it's also like there is a tipping point, right, where you're filling up someone's brain up to a certain point. And at a certain point, it's going to get to the point where they are going to say to themselves, I don't know if I can remember all this next time. And at that point, that's when you are really walking a fine line, because if you don't want to really, you don't really want to blast through that and get to the point where they're like, okay, cool. So now, what does this do again? Oh gosh, there are more colors I don't know. You don't want to make it daunting to them. So if you're teaching them with two decks, it could just be like red versus blue or red versus white or whatever. And the next time you play, like, okay, the next time we play, we're going to introduce black. And black's a whole different world of flavor and cards and creatures that do certain things and creatures that can't do certain things because it's not in their color zone or whatever. It's not associated with their color. So really make sure that you know that teaching is not just a one-time affair. You didn't learn magic in one go, and no one else is going to either.
Okay, so that is our 10 rules for teaching magic. You know, we've all have this friend, and they sort of hang around at the periphery, and they ask questions, but they haven't played the game. You know, they've seen us playing. You know, maybe you go out to them next time and go, hey, you know, why don't we take 20 minutes here, and I'll just teach you the basics of the game. It's really easy, you know, to just quickly play a couple of games from a simple standpoint once you've built these decks, you know, these simple decks. And, you know, it's amazing. You're giving a really good gift to your friend, and you're giving a gift to yourself too, because, you know, they're going to be somebody that you can potentially play Magic with, you know, for years to come.
And they might be someone that beats you eventually, that you will have to learn to get better to play against them. And that is the ultimate situation, because you're essentially just making yourself better, a better player, and them at the same time.
And there's, you know, there's a great amount of pride when somebody that you introduce something to, you taught them, they become your equal at it or even better than you at it. It's like, wow, you know, that you can feel really good about that, because, you know, if the student ever becomes the master and they're telling you things and they're interacting with you, they're talking about, you know, interactions that they see that you didn't see, like there's a lot of pride there from the student or from the teacher standpoint.
Yeah, that's like the movie moment, you know, where the Karate Kid becomes the master or, you know, wins the tournament, and, you know, it wasn't you going out there and fighting the fight for them. You know, they were the ones that ultimately had to be out there and doing it themselves. And without your guidance, you know, you learn something from them and they learn something from you. So it's really great.
When I left, it's Darth Vader, right? It's when I left you, I was but the learner. Now I am the master.
Exactly. Oh, man. I did not even think we'd ever bring Star Wars into this in the conversation, so I'm glad we did. And also for those guys out there that don't want to sit around and build a deck, Wizards also provides a lot of stuff that is very helpful in this regard. The dual decks, I think some of them are very simple enough that can also be great learning experiences, and they're built to play each other, you know? I think that if you do build decks, dual decks are like the next level up that you can do to help someone out to, okay, cool, now let's play some with some more complex decks that were meant to fight each other and specifically have synergies to play against each other.
Yeah, that's really smart. That's a really good idea, is like as your second step, your second stepping stone to sort of continuing to grow and learn magic, you know, after you've used the simple decks for a little while. Yeah, those dual decks are great. And, they just announced that they're coming out with they're reprinting a lot of the old ones, which is awesome. There's a lot of opportunity there to sort of continue a student's education, in a really fun way. So, keep that in mind.
Yeah, and I think there's a beauty in being able to play multiple games with the same decks against each other, because you start learning the ins and outs of each deck. And it's very similar when you know you're like playing any competitive event, is that you need to know what's coming at you or be able to predict it. And I think that's a huge part of the game too. So like being able to play the decks, knowing what potentially might be coming at you, is a really important way, another step to learning and upping your level of your game.
Okay, so we've got a commander spotlight. This is one of your commanders, Jimmy. Do you want to introduce
him? Yes. His name is Rafiq of the Many. He is a legendary creature, human knight. He was initially printed in Shards of Alara, and he's been reprinted in From the Vault Legends. And he is a Bant commander, and he costs 4 total, one colorless, and green, white, and blue. And Rafiq of the Many is, his flavor text is many sigils, one purpose. And that purpose is killing people as fast as possible in one...
It's to kill you.
One swift strike. I'll read his text. He is, first text is a exalted, and that keyword means whenever a creature you control attacks alone, that creature gets +1/+1 until end of turn. So this basically means that you always want to be attacking with one guy with his generals out on the board, because it gives that creature just an extra little buff But Rafiq is an excellent commander because his second ability is whenever a creature you control attacks alone, it gains double strike until end of turn.
So what this means for both abilities is if you're only attacking with one creature, any creature, doesn't have to be Rafiq, just any of your creatures is only attacking by itself, then it gets these buffs, which is exalted, so it gets +1/+1, and then it gets double strike. So, you know, if Rafiq's your biggest guy or your best guy at the moment, then you attack with him by himself and he gets that stuff. But if you have something else that's bigger or better for whatever reason, then you attack with it by itself and it gets double strike and +1/+1.
And essentially, thinking about it, this ability is really powerful because Rafiq is a 3/3. And if you swing by himself, he just hits for 3. Wah, wah. But if he triggers all the text on his card, then he gets +1/+1 for the 4/4, and he double strikes, so he hits for 8.
That's with nothing on him.
Yeah, that's
with
nothing
on
him.
By himself, that's 8 commander damage, boom,
yeah.
For a 4 casting cost guy.
Yeah, so that's pretty ridiculous, especially when you're just trying to get to 21 commander to shut someone out of the game. So he is powerful by himself, but of course, commander is about the 99 cards you build around your commander, and that means that you are essentially trying to get other creatures out that have exalted, because if two people have exalted, then that +1/+1 turns into +2/+2/+2 because both those cards add exalted stack.
Yeah, however many cards you have on the table with exalted, they'll all add the +1/+1 to the singular attacking creature you have.
Yep. So if there's another exalted card out there, Rafiq starts swinging for 8. Now sort swing for 10 because he goes from 3/3 to 4/4 with exalted, and then 5/5 with a second exalted, and double strike that. So as you can imagine, this kind of gets out of hand pretty quickly, and as if it's not answered.
It's crazy. I've been killed by it many times.
Yeah, and I have 2, which is why I decided to make a deck, because it just seemed like too much fun, especially on 1v1 situations, because I think he's a great commander 1v1, and he's also really fun to pile at multiplayer because it really becomes a politics game, because once people know what Rafiq does, they're going to want to, a lot of people sort of want to aim for him first.
So one thing to keep in mind when you're building the deck is that you're almost always going to be attacking with only one creature at a time. So it's not one of those decks where you're attacking with like 2, 3, 6 guys at once. You know, you're going to be the most optimal. You're going to get the maximum out of all your triggers, your exalted triggers, when you attack with one thing. So that's an important thing to keep in your head as you build this deck.
Yeah. So it's kind of like a Voltron deck where you can kind of just want one big guy to get stacked up with a bunch of stuff to swing in for the win, essentially. And it's cool though, because the Voltron in this deck can move to any creature at any time because it's not an equipment, you know, exalted stacks on whoever is attacking alone. So that creature that I have in this deck are for utility and for max damage. So the basics are add exalted, make them unblockable, and then deplete 40 life, commander or not.
Or, as we'll see, there are other ways to kill somebody. You know, once
yes.
you have enough exalted and there are other abilities. So, yeah, let's talk about some exalted cards, you know, that belong
Definitely.
In the deck. So, what do you think the most important one is?
To me, I think the most important card is Sublime Archangel. She is very special. She's 2/2 white, a creature angel that's 4/3 flying. She has exalted. And the other important thing is other creatures you control have exalted.
It's crazy.
So when we said exalted stacks, this is what will happen. If you have Sublime Archangel out for Rafiq and 2 other guys, every one of those creatures has exalted, and all of a sudden you have Sublime Archangel adding 1 exalted, Rafiq adding 1, and 2 other creatures adding 1.
All of a sudden they're adding 4 power and toughness to him, and then he gives double strike. It's just, it gets crazy really fast.
Yeah, and even if Rafiq can't swing, you know, as a 3/3 body that becomes now a 7/7 for 14, then Sublime Archangel can swing in the air, you know, for 8 × 2, 16 damage, and that's almost half of someone's life in Commander. So Sublime Archangel is great because the more creatures you have on the board, the stronger everyone gets. She's just such a scary, scary card to come out and almost requires an answer because she's just going to really... she's going to make Rafiq do some work.
Okay, so the next card, a good exalted card, is actually a land. It's called Cathedral of War. It's a land that comes into the battlefield tapped, and the land itself has exalted. And you can tap it for 1 colorless. So it's a land that adds +1/+1 to whichever one of your creatures is attacking, which is, you know, These are the types of cards I've talked about in the past that I really like because they fulfill two spots in your deck. You know, it works as a land and it does the mechanic that you're trying to do.
And the nice thing about it too is that it's not really going to be the target of a lot of people. A lot of people very often don't even realize that it's sitting out there when you attack for so much, and it's like, wait, how's he swinging for that much? And you're like, and you point at the land, and you're like, oh, I see. While a creature like Sublime Archangel is definitely going to be the subject of removal, a land like Cathedral of War definitely can slip by unnoticed for a lot more often.
Yeah, it's pretty innocuous. It rarely will get taken out.
Yeah, which is pretty great. Another really fun card is Finest Hour, and this is a deck that I think can be really heavy in enchantments. Finest Hour is a 2 and Bant, so it's 5 total, 2 green, white, and blue, and it's an enchantment that just gives Exalted, and also says whenever a creature you control attacks for alone, if it's the first combat phase of the turn, untap that creature. After this phase, there is an additional combat phase. So Finest Hour essentially does two things. One, it's already asking you to do what you want to do with the deck, which is attack with one creature per turn, and it gives everyone Exalted on top of that. And on top of that, as a reward, it gives you another attack step. Not to mention, that person on the card is Rafiq.
Yeah, this card is crazy. If you get this Cathedral of War and like one other Exalted thing, you're hitting them for 12 with Rafiq, 12 commander damage. Then you get to untap and do another combat phase. Hit them again, they're dead.
Yep. That's a single turn win right there.
Yeah, it's not difficult with Finest Hour out to just kill somebody. With Finest Hour out to just kill somebody. That card is, dare I say, bonkers.
Yeah, I think you can dare to say it.
So the next category we have that's important is, you know, once you're going to be making your one creature like really big with Exalted and some other things, then, you know, it's really important that they connect their damage through to one of the opposing players. So unblockability is very important. One of the best cards for this, we've talked about it many times in the past, is Whisper Silk Cloak.
Yeah, just one of the best equipments in general and almost a mainstay in every commander deck I've seen.
Yeah, and yet somehow even more important in this deck because it's, if you don't know, Whisper Silk Cloak is an artifact equipment, costs 3 to put out and 2 to equip, and an equipped creature is unblockable and has Shroud. So this does two things you really want, which is they're unblockable, so they're going to get their damage through, and also it protects the creature because the creature has Shroud.
Yep. And usually the creature that you're equipping this to is going to be a threat because, you know, if, for instance, putting this on something like Sublime Archangel is an excellent choice or any of your other huge creatures because people want to get rid of it. And Shroud is one of those excellent ways of just giving a protection across the board that they have to get rid of the cloak beforehand. But at that point, you know, this guy's already going to be swinging for a huge amount of damage.
Yeah, this is a way to get Rafiq through or any of your creatures through for just, you know, a ton of damage. Rafiq's giving him double strike. Everything else is giving him +1/+1. And all of a sudden, like, something's just swinging for, like, 20 damage.
Yeah.
You know, and you can't block it and you can't kill it. It's brutal. What's another card that gives unblockable that I really like is Rogue's Passage.
Yep. Again, another commander card that I think should be in most decks, which is just a land that adds 1 to your mana pool. And for 4 mana, you can tap it and target creature is unblockable this turn. Which makes it super effective because this allows you to choose sort of, you know, you get to choose who's unblockable this turn.
Yeah, and again, it's a land and it taps for colorless mana, so it's useful, you know, and while you're not using it for the unblockability thing. It's doing something else that your deck needs to do, which is produce mana.
Yeah, absolutely. And my other favorite card in these colors is Thassa, God of Sea, because she is just a 3 mana indestructible enchantment. And very rarely is she going to come online and get the devotion up to make her a creature, which is great because she both allows you to scry every upkeep and also just for 1 and a blue, make a creature unblockable. And that is, in my lexicon, that's bonkers because that's super cheap to do it. And, worst comes to worst, if you need to swing with everyone because you have no other choice and you can't do the exalted stacks,
you can make everyone
unblockable.
Well, and also, she's basically like Rogue's Passage, but just cheaper. You know, instead of 4, you can just pay 2. And the Scry 1 ability is very important for, you know, just evening out your draws and making the game go more smoothly for you.
Yeah.
So she's very powerful in the deck.
Yeah.
The next category we call Make It Matter. So it's like, okay, I got my creatures out with Exalted. You know, they're going to be pretty big. I make them unblockable, so they're going to get through and hit the opponent. And so I just want to make sure that that matters, that has the biggest impact it can have. So, you know, there's a couple ways that this can work. One is the cold-eyed Selkie.
Which one of my favorites.
Yeah, which is a 1-1. It has island walk, so sometimes it's just... it's a 1-1 for 3 mana, so it's a hybrid green-blue 1. It's a 1-1 with island walk, and it says, whenever cold-eyed Selkie deals combat damage to a player, you may draw that many cards.
Nice.
So upon first reading, you know, some people go, well, this isn't much better than, say, Scroll Thief, which is 3 mana for a 1-3, and when it causes combat damage to an opponent, you draw a card. But the Selkie says you may draw that many cards. So mm-hmm. as much damage as it does, you draw that many cards. So with Exalted and Double Strike, even if only Rafiq's out on the table, you're going to draw 4 cards.
4 cards, and the Island Walk is so important because who doesn't play blue in a multiplayer game?
Well, and you're playing against maybe 4 other players or 3 other players, there's a really good chance that one of them's got blue, one of them's got islands, and so you just get to draw a free 4 cards or more.
Yeah, and that's nuts. That's better than almost any other draw engine you can put in a deck, is because you can, you know, there's always going to be a target for the Selkie to attack, and if you get even just a couple more, if you get 2 Exalted on there, you're drawing 6 cards every single turn. Oh my gosh. If you don't win the game from that point, it's going to be...
Well, and also, like, you have a lot of cards that give things unblockable, because it's one of the goals of the deck. So even if the Island Walk doesn't matter, you can still make the Selkie unblockable. So if you don't have enough damage to kill somebody, you can at least draw into the cards that will give you that amount of damage. So, yeah. So another card that, if you can make it unblockable, is very, very powerful, is the Hydra Omnivore.
Printed in Commander, too. Yeah, it's meant to be played in Commander.
And it was mm-hmm. recently in Conspiracy. It's a really strong card. It's 6 mana, 4 and 2 green for a creature Hydra. It's an 8/8.
Hold
it's
on.
Already
wait.
Awesome. 6 mana for an 8/8.
8/8 for a 6?
Yeah.
They better have some kind of downside. Let's hear the downside.
Nope. It's got the opposite. It has the opposite of a downside. It says, whenever Hydra Omnivore deals combat damage to an opponent, it deals that much damage to each other opponent. So if you swing through... Let's just say Rafiq's out and you make this thing's unblockable. So it's a 9/9 with double strike. It's going to do 18 damage to all your opponents.
Oh, my gosh.
This is one of those cards we talk about in Commander, which is like your ability to kill every other player at the table in one turn. This guy gives you that ability. You know, with just pumping it a couple of times, with another card we didn't talk about earlier, like Berserk.
Yeah.
You want to read Berserk?
Yes. So Berserk is probably the one of the strongest combat tricks. It's a 1 green for an instant. So it's a total of 1 CMC. Cast Berserk only before combat damage is dealt. No problem. Target creature gains trample and gets +X/+0 until end of turn, where X is its power. At the end of the end step, destroy that creature if it attacked this turn. So with Hydra Omnivore on the board, it would get 6. It would go to a 16/16.
Well, if it was by itself, if there's an Exalted trigger or two out,
or 16/8.
It's pretty easy for it to be a double strike, you know, 20/20, and then you just kill everybody.
Yeah, exactly, because the Exalted triggers starts before combat damage is dealt. So he would swing in for as a 9/9, and you would double that to an 18/9.
Yeah, so if you had one other Exalted trigger, if you had Rafiq, one other Exalted trigger, like a Cathedral of War, and then you Berserk him, the Omnivore, you kill everybody.
Yeah, essentially.
Yeah.
because you're swinging in for 4.
I want to do that.
Yeah, and the best part about multiplayer with Rafiq is that there's always going to be someone that you can probably swing at. You know, maybe not the guy next to you, but a card like Hydra Omnivore is like, I don't care who has what on the table. As long as I can get through to one person, that's all that matters. And the fact that it's 6 mana for an 8/8, too, is just like, what happened here? This is a nuts card.
Yeah.
It has no downside. Literally no downside.
There's no downside to that card. It's just awesome. Yeah.
That's making everyone want to kill you. If they even can.
Yeah, exactly. If you can drop it and put Swiftfoot boots on it, it doesn't matter what they want to do. They're just going to be dead.
Yep. Pretty much.
The other thing I would say is Infect.
Oh.
Because
Infect. Ugh.
Yeah, it's great to deal 40 damage to him or 21 commander damage to him. It's a lot easier to just deal 10 damage to them.
Yeah.
So if you can give a creature infect or else play a creature that has infect and get it up to 10 power, you know, that can end the game right there. So one of the cards is Putrefax. So that's a 5 mana. That's 3 and 2 green for a creature horror. It's a 5/3. It has trample, very important, and haste. Haste, super important too. It has infect, which means the creature deals damage to other creatures in the form of -1/-1 counters and to players in the form of poison counters. We've talked about this before, but if you ever get 10 poison counters as a player, you're dead. You lose the game.
You are poisoned to death.
Yep. And it says at the beginning of the end step, sacrifice Putrefax. So you get to use him once, but he's a 5/3 already. He has trample and haste. So that means if you have Rafiq out and you play Putrefax, if they can't kill it or have something with high enough toughness to absorb a lot of the damage, they're dead.
Yep. He really can just come in and swing in for the win because he is haste, and the trample really does make a huge difference because they can't just chump block him.
The trample makes a huge difference because if they've only got a 2/2 out, they're just dead.
Yep. And if you have more exalted stacks, then they're even... The trade that they have to make is a really not good for them because double strike means that he's going to swing in for 6 or 7 for that first hit, and then there are not that many creatures that have above 7 toughness. So even if you can't swing with Putrefax for the win, they're probably going to have to sacrifice something significant to die to it, which is optimal.
Yeah, I'd say most of the times they have to sacrifice 2 or 3 creatures to it just because it'll have double strike, it'll have exalted. If it has exalted from 2 or 3 more places, like it's swinging in for like, let's say 16 or 18 damage. So they have to somehow absorb 7 to 9 of that damage to just not die to the poison counters. You know, a lot of times that takes 2-3 creatures.
Yeah.
You know, a lot of times they just don't have it and they're just dead too. I mean, you can do it on turn 5.
Yeah.
So
it's rough.
Yeah, this card is really, really good in this deck.
Yeah, especially if it's like someone hits it a board wipe and you have a Putrefax in your hand, you're like, well, I think I'm gonna do some damage. And you're able to cast Rafiq at, you know, and just protect him from that board wipe. Or even if you have spot removal, you know, you can take out their blocker and be like, well, guess you're gonna die now.
I mean, you'd only need 9 mana. It'd have to be the right colors. But if somebody board wiped and you had 9 mana and you had Putrefax in hand, you just play Rafiq, play Putrefax, kill somebody.
Yeah, and that's sort of the beauty of this deck is that, yeah, it's like it can make that happen, and it has the ability to really just come out of nowhere and just take someone out. And another card that has infect that does that is Spinebiter. He's so mean because he doesn't even need... He's less conditional than Putrefax is. He's 4/2 green for a 3/4 body. And at first it's like, 3/4, that's not that good for infect. But Rafiq's out and he becomes a 4/5. And if you literally only need one other exalted card, because his big text is, you may have Spinebiter assign its combat damage as though it weren't blocked. So he's essentially unblockable because... He can swing at anyone. They can block however they want. I'm going to assign this combat damage, and I'm going to assign it as though it wasn't blocked, and you just take 10 infect.
Yeah, if you can get him to 5 power and Rafiq's out, he has double strike, and you're just dead.
Yep, just like that.
Mean.
Super mean. And Spinebiter is definitely one of those creatures that I search up if I can tutor for one, and I need to just end someone's game really quickly.
Another really powerful card in this deck is called Grafted Exoskeleton. It's an equipment. It costs 4 to put out and 2 to equip. It says, equipped creature gets +2/+2 and has infect. Whenever Grafted Exoskeleton becomes unattached from a permanent, sacrifice that permanent. So that part, who cares? The important part is you get +2/+2 and infect.
Yep.
So you can turn any creature into an instant killing machine. You know, if they're unblockable, if they have Whisper Silk Cloak and you have Rafiq out, actually all you need is Rafiq.
Yeah.
And unblockable Rafiq, and this.
Yeah. Because he'd do it himself.
Yeah, because he'll be a 6/6. With double strike and infect, and so he'll just kill him.
Yeah, and introduced by Craig, our least favorite infect player, aka the only infect player that we know.
I mean, we might throw some infect in our decks, but he loves infect. It's in all his decks.
And I mean, here's the thing. It's like, it's an amazing win condition for Commander because, like, let's say the board is so stalled out that, and there's things that you can't really do to get around it. Infect is one of those great ways to just, that guy that, you know, because of his Sarah Ascendant is at 60 life, just dies.
Yeah, it's kind of like a loophole in the system, you know? It's like, I don't care how much, what life you're at or, you know, how many whatevers you've got. You know, 10 poison counters dead.
Yeah. And like that's a pretty powerful, and I really don't blame anyone for playing infect because there are ways to stop it from happening too. And you know, it ultimately is just kind of your fault if you can't stop it from happening, unless it's Spinebiter, in which case it's like there's just nothing you can do about that.
Well, you need instant speed removal.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, good.
We've talked about that before. Okay, let's move on to the next section, which we call protection. So any Voltron-y deck, any deck that's trying to sort of build a super creature, they always want to protect that creature.
Yep.
So, you know, we've got the normal stuff. We talked about Whisper Silk Cloak. We've talked about Swiftfoot Boots in the past, but this one has some unique ones.
Yeah. One of them is a card that actually just came out in M15, which I really like, along the law commander decks, which is the Soul of New Phyrexia. It's a 6 mana cost, colorless, 6/6 with trample. And for 5 mana, you can pay it, permanent to control, gain indestructible until end of turn. And the second ability is essentially the same thing, 5 mana, exile Soul of New Phyrexia from a graveyard, permanent to control, gain indestructible until end of turn. And this is just like, stop the board wipe. You know, this is hey, guess what? You can't kill my creatures now because...
You can't kill all my stuff.
Yeah, for 5 mana.
Unless it's Toxic Deluge, which is the best board wipe.
Yeah, exactly. Or like a Path to Exile. You can't really do much about that. But it's a great card because it has a lot of utility. You know, it can toss into your bin and still be used from there to stop one thing. And also just as a 6/6 body with Trample, it's great with Rafiq.
Yeah, it's actually awesome because if you put the, you know, if you gave it Infect or whatever, you don't even need to make it unblockable because Trample is its own form of evasion.
Yeah.
So with a couple Exalted triggers and Double Strike from Rafiq, you know, you could kill somebody with this thing, not too difficult.
Yeah, definitely got a lot of power behind him and utility of being able to just stop everyone from destroying their stuff for just 5 mana. That's an amazing answer to a board wipe.
Again, this is another one of those cards we really like because it's doing two things. It acts as a creature with Trample, you know, that can attack and block and do damage, but it also acts as protection for your creatures.
Yeah.
So instead of a card that only does one of those things, it does both. So it's very, it's very strong in this deck.
Yeah, definitely.
Another card I like, or I should say I hate, because you know, whenever you play this deck and this card comes out, I'm like, oh crap, how are we ever gonna win? It's Asceticism. It's a green enchantment. It costs 3 and 2 green. It says creatures you control can't be the targets of spells or abilities your opponents control.
Already then, amazing in itself.
Yeah, and then if that wasn't, they just kick you while you're down. And, you know, if you're the opponent. And it says, pay 1 and a green, regenerate target creature. So it protects them in two ways. They can't be the targets of spells or abilities, so instant speed removal doesn't even work anymore. And then you can regenerate your dudes, and you can do that for as many times as you've got 2 mana available.
Ugh.
This thing, it's just ridiculous. Because all of a sudden, like, I can't even deal with your stuff by, you know, just killing it.
Yeah, and you have to have exile stuff to, like, really get rid of stuff. And even then, you can't, because your creatures can't get targeted.
Can't be spot targeted.
Yep.
It would have to be exile, you know, all whatevers, you know. Yeah, it's really tough once this gets out on the table for this deck to lose. I mean, that would have to just be killed in the next turn or something.
Yeah, and also it means that creatures that can start swinging in at you and you can't even block efficiently because they can just regenerate anything that ends up poorly for them.
Yep. Yeah, this is a really, really strong card.
Yeah, definitely. Another great card, though, in this case is very simple and very innocuous, but it's Mother of Runes.
Oh, yeah. This card should be around in more decks, I think.
Yeah, and she does work. It's not the Mother of Dragons, for you Game of Thrones fans. She's just...
Can we just call her Khaleesi from now on?
Yeah, right. She should just be target dragon you control. So Mother of Runes is just a 1 mana cost, 1 white, and you can tap her, and target creature you control gains protection from a color of your choice until end of turn. And it just makes... It may not seem like a lot, but every time Mother of Runes hits the table, like, you gotta realize she can also target herself, and so that means that people can't get rid of her. If they want to get rid of her, if they got to get rid of her and something else, they have to essentially make her tap you down with one spell and then use another spell to get rid of what they want to. So it's essentially a stopgap.
Yeah, exactly. And they sort of, or they could use 2 things of 2 different colors on the same thing. So they could try and Doomblade her. She gives herself protection from black, and then they path to exile her. And then they need another thing to get rid of the thing that they really want to kill. it's brutal.
Yeah.
This is a really good card for protecting one of your important creatures. The good thing about this deck is, like, none of the creatures by themselves are, you know, normal Voltron decks, you're building one big creature, and if that thing goes down, you're in big trouble. But in this deck, the way Exalted works, like, any one of your creatures is pretty powerful. So you might get rid of the worst one, but that the second one gets all the Exalted triggers that other one would have got, and they're still pretty awesome. They're still pretty badass, and they're still a force to be reckoned with. So I think that's a really strong aspect of this deck, is it's really hard with spot removal to just take care of the deck like you can with a normal Voltron deck.
Yep, being able to swing the exalted to anyone is really important. And like Rafiq says, he's Rafiq of the many. So all your creatures of the many are all going to be really a threat on the board at any given time.
Okay, let's talk about some cards you may not think of.
Umezawa's Jite.
Yeah, I didn't want to have to pronounce
or,
that.
Or Umezawa's Jit. probably.
Umezawa Jit.
I don't even know.
That's like Quesadilla.
Is correct. Yeah, right. So many cards.
Quesadilla or Fajita. I've heard somebody say that before.
You know that McDonald's used to have fajitas? I'm serious. I used to, when I was a kid, I would always get fajitas from McDonald's, and people were always like, What are you eating? That's not Big Mac.
I don't like to order anything from McDonald's that's not like a hamburger or fries or chicken nuggets.
Yeah,
like
I agree.
I don't know if I trust them to make me no fajitas.
I don't think I trust anyone to make me a quote-unquote fajita. So Umezawa's Jite is probably one of the best equipments ever printed. It's from Kamigawa, Betrayers of Kamigawa specifically. It's 2 mana and a legendary artifact equipment, and it costs 2 to equip. Whenever equipped creature deals combat damage, to put 2 charge counters on Umezawa's Jite. And then the second text is, remove a charge counter from Umezawa's Jite. Choose 1. Equipped creature gets +2/+2 until end of turn. Ugh. Target creature gets -1/-1 until end of turn. Or you gain 2 life. All of these are incredibly effective. There's so many little things you can kill with a -1/-1. But I think the first one is the most important. And the other thing, too, realizes that Rafiq out, if someone is equipped with this card says whenever equipped creature does combat damage, and if you're double striking someone twice, you're going to do combat damage twice, so you get to have 4 charge counters on this thing essentially every time that you swing it.
It's crazy.
It is really crazy. And the other thing with double strike is that you swing at a guy, right? He swings in, first strike damage is hit, and then if it's dealt combat damage, then you get 2 charge counters.
You immediately put the counters on.
So you can actually remove those counters immediately to give it +4/+4 for the second strike, which is just insane. Yeah. Because it's instant speed, and you can do it in between first strike and regular combat damage.
It's really not hard if you get this on Rafiq or if Rafiq's out at all to just kill somebody.
Yeah, Rafiq by himself. Okay, so he swings with this, he hits for 4 the first time, and then you can remove 2 encounters, and then he's gonna hit for 8 the next time, so 12 commander damage in a single strike, which is just, as we like to say, bonkers.
Bonkers!
Bonkers.
Yeah, that's a great card. Another one I like is Cephalid Constable.
Ugh.
It's 3 mana, that's 1/2 blue, for a Cephalid Wizard, a 1/1. It says, whenever Cephalid Constable deals combat damage to a player, return up to that many target permanents that player controls to their owner's hands.
Yep.
That's the sound I make every time this happens to me.
Yeah, this card is as shut down as it gets, I think. People will not like you for playing it, but... because it means that you get to return 2 permanents, essentially, with Double Strike. And it means...
No, you get 4.
4, that's right. Ugh, oh my gosh. Yeah, up to that many.
Just
yeah,
4.
So
if it was just 4. 4. If 4 is all 4. You get, it's like, that's target permanents. That's 4 lands, that's their artifacts, that's enchantments, that's the creatures. You know, that's if only Rafiq is out and you can connect with the Constable, you know, which is like one unblockable effect. Never mind if you have 2 or 3 other exalted things. All of a sudden, you're returning like 8 to 10...
Yep.
Of their permanents. If you return 8 permanents back to somebody's hands, they're done.
They're done. That game is over for them because they're neither not going to be able to play them all or force to discard them or.
I mean, some of those are going to be lands. Like, they're not going to just have 8 things out.
Yeah, exactly. And that's the scary thing is that if you get this out early enough, you can essentially lock someone out of the game, which is why people will not be happy for you for playing.
I mean, if you make it unblockable, you can do that to one person, then the next turn do it to the next person. I mean.
Yep. With Finest Hour, you can do it to multiple people at the same turn.
Oh my god! I mean, you will automatically win if you can.
Yeah.
If you do it to two to every player at the table, this card is bonkers. It's crazy.
Yeah.
We're saying bonkers too many times. I'm sorry.
But,
but it is
true though.
Yeah,
Rafiq decks often get that nice quality of.
Can you tell I've been hit by that thing before? It sucks.
Yeah, and I love the flavor text too, which is Cephalids don't police people, they police loyalties, which is great when you're returning lands and
that is some good flavor, actually.
Impermanence. Yeah,
I think our friend James Bianco would approve.
Yeah, James, if you like Cephalid Constable, let us know, because we love it. Yeah, that card definitely brings a lot of hate to you at the table for obvious reasons.
Yeah.
Obvious reasons. Another card that you may not think of is the equipment that I don't see often enough in Commander, and I don't know why, because
it feels like we should see it more. Yeah,
it is also nuts. It is quite a spike. 3 mana equipment, 3 to equip. Equip creature has death touch, so already this is an amazing thing with double strike, because it means that you essentially will win most combat because you're gonna first strike them with death touch. And whenever equipped creature deals combat damage to a player, that player loses half his or her life rounded up.
That's crazy.
You're going to deal combat damage twice, by the way, if you're unblockable.
Yeah, if you're unblocked, you hit them twice, and then so they're down to a quarter of their life just from that.
Yeah, so let's do the math here. Rafiq swings by himself, 4-4. He does first strike damage for 4. They go from 40 to 36, divide by half, it's 18. He swings again from 18 to 14. Divide that by half in 7.
In you one took... swing with nothing. That's just him and the spike.
That's just him and the spike. That is nuts.
Ouch.
I mean, I can't even imagine how crazy this is with a couple more exalted stacks. You will literally be able to finish off someone in a single turn. And if it's not you, someone else will. Because it's
insane.
Like at that point, you can almost lava axe someone and kill them.
Okay, so the next section is cards that you might think are good in the deck, but you know maybe aren't 100% optimal.
Yep.
Is Kira, Great Glass Spinner. She's used a lot in Commander all over the place, but I'll read her. She's 1 and 2 blue for a legendary creature spirit. She's a 2-2 flyer. Her text says, creatures you control have, whenever this creature becomes the target of a spell or ability for the first time in a turn, counter that spell or ability. So she
was... seems good.
Yeah, it seems great. It seems like it protects your guys. You know, it seems like it makes them a lot harder to kill. Anybody that has, like, Path to Exile and Swords to Plowshares would have to use both of them on any given creature just to kill it. And you're usually going to have to kill Kira first before you kill the other thing. Otherwise, you're just not getting rid of the problem. So all of a sudden, I need 3 spot removal spells to get rid of your big Voltron dude. It just seems really good. But, you know, the issue you run into is that you're going to be using in this deck quite a few of your own spells and abilities, like Mother of Runes, Berserk, which we just talked about. You know,
any equipment.
Yeah, and equipment you have to equip twice. If you have Kira out, because she stops your own spells and abilities too, so it's just becomes a real pain in the butt, a real headache if you have her out, and you know it may or may not be worth it. I personally think it's not.
Yeah, I mean, I could see this as in some situational cases, but this is a deck where you want to target your own creatures, either to protect them or to give them that extra buff that they need to swing in for the big hit. So Kira just makes that really constricting on your own mana. Like having to pay an equipment cost twice just to get something on someone, it's such a waste of your own mana that you have cards that like Asceticism and Mother of Runes and other cards that do the same thing that you don't want Kira.
Yeah, exactly.
You don't want
Other things that maybe aren't as good, pump spells in general are just too little impact, I think. You know, it feels like you might want to like Titanic Growth or whatever, you know, because that's generally good with Infect stuff. But Infect is not the main thing you're doing. It's just, it works with what you're doing. So you have a few Infect cards in there, but you're not going to count on any given game actually having Infect on the board.
Yeah, and that's not to say you shouldn't have it in any pump spells. I think Berserk is definitely worth it.
Yeah, it's so strong that it's in there, yeah.
Yeah, so you just have to be careful because, you know, in this deck, you know, it's going to do the damage with or without pump spells. It's going to still get it in for a ton of damage. And in a lot of cases, I think you have enough win conditions with Infect and having the Exalted triggers already that you're already pumping your guy up 3 or 4 with the Exalted triggers that you don't need to pump on top of that. And that spot is better reserved for a card that could protect your creatures because you're going to be the target of a lot of people.
Okay, Jimmy, so, you know, you've played this deck a lot. Let's talk about how to combat this deck, so how I fight it. So, you know, when you're playing this deck, what's the type of stuff that you're like, oh, no, like that, you know, like how am I going to deal with that? Or, oh, crap, I hope they don't do this. Like, what are those type of things?
Well, definitely one of the main things about this deck is that it's not an aggro deck in early turns, right? Rafiq costs 4 to put out. A lot of your big beaters that really do a lot of damage are 5 mana, 6 mana. A lot of the equipment requires about 5 to 6 mana just to get out and equip and all that stuff. So having instant speed removal in the early stages of the game is really important. For instance, if I foolishly pull out Rafiq and people have untapped mana, it would not be a bad play to just wipe him off the board immediately.
Right.
By exiling him or making him more to cast the second time around. So you need time as a player to set up so the protection you need for the deck, and that's when this deck is really weak, is that is that early game where you can really get damage easily, and if you're not much you can do about it, or if you're attacking into their blockers and they have guys that, you know, with Exalted, they may not necessarily want to block with because that helps fuel their deck. So getting in early and getting in fast is a really great way to beat this deck, as is, of course, board wipes.
I think you sort of need instant speed board wipes, though, because,
yeah,
you know, not always, but a lot of times you're making something unblockable, like right now, and it's protected by something like Asceticism, and the only thing I can do is board wipe. You know, even if you regenerate it, at least that stops the attack from killing me right now.
Yeah.
You know, yeah, so, you know, board wipes with Quicken or just instant speed board wipes, or something like Toxic Deluge, which, you know, doesn't care if you're indestructible or you can regenerate.
Yeah. And another big thing is also like just chump blockers. A lot of the creatures in here do have trample and do have special abilities that help get them over your creatures, but having chump blockers will definitely give you a little more sustain. Because even if they kill your first chump blocker and get through the second on damage, at least they're not hitting you for twice that, you know, they're only getting half of it. So it's just like a normal hit. But it's still really, really scary. So I'd say like instant speed removal is definitely the most important thing. Mm-hmm. And knowing which key creatures to get rid of. Rafiq is definitely the biggest target.
Anything with infect.
Yeah, anything with infect. Stuff that also gives...
I think artifact destruction would be pretty powerful against this too, because a lot of its reliance on equipment to make unblockable or to give an infect or whatever. So yeah, that's going to be pretty strong.
Enchantment removal too, for sure. Especially a card like Thassa, if left unanswered, can really wreak havoc because she's so hard to get rid of because she's indestructible and all that. So having a card artifact and enchantment responses is good, because Asceticism undealt with will... win that person the game.
It's so hard to deal with Asceticism if you don't just remove the Asceticism. So yeah, it's a super strong card. So lastly, do you want to talk about just generally when you're piloting this deck, like what you're thinking about and how you're playing it?
Yeah, so I mean, the big thing is like you need to focus on one player at a time, and it makes a big difference, because if you just try and spread out the big damage as some deck trying to do, you're going to find that you're just going to make everyone angry at you and they're all just going to target you. I find that piggybacking on someone that is already about to go down the drain is really effective, because that doesn't necessarily make anyone else feel like you're about to target them or whatever. Because if someone else is attacking, they're like, okay, I'll hop on this train and kill them first. That person that's attacking them won't be like, okay, cool. Now I'm going to attack someone else or whatever. Like, it's like, cool, now we're focusing on this person together, and you can play the politics of that up
smart.
A little bit. Yeah, and also, like, there's cards like Silent Arbiter that essentially enforce your game mechanic on the rest of the board.
Oh, yeah, we didn't talk about that card, but that card is really good in this deck, because you're only attacking with one guy ever anyway.
Yeah, exactly. And if you can force everyone to only block with one person, that means your guys with Trample or Infect are really going to get through, and you have to really, you know, like, sack someone hard. And Silent Arbiter is just a 4-mana artifact, which says no more than one creature can attack each combat, and no more one creature can block each combat. So it's exactly what you want to do with the deck, and it enforces it for everyone else, and it really does help you
out. It's also protection. Like, you know, all of a sudden they can't crack back at you. I mean, what's a token deck supposed to do against you then? They can only block with one of their dudes, and they can't attack with their, you know, they can have 500 guys out. You don't care.
Yeah, Silent Arbiter is just a great meta card, too, just to stop token decks, too, like overrun abilities and stuff. He's just amazing for that. Yeah, and the big thing is, too, is just, like, keep counters up. Get, you know, your Plasm Catchers or your Void Snare, and make sure that you're able to...
Or just counterspell.
Just counterspells. Yeah, you are in blue. You do have the whole host of counters at your disposal. And that's really going to help give you that extra turn that you need. Because oftentimes with Rafiq, I found that you just need one more turn and you'd be able to do it. You know,
yeah.
So if someone stops you that turn or turn early, then, you know, game over.
This is a really cool deck. I mean, it's not cool when it's pounding me in the face, but yeah, I admire this deck. But I won't admit that next time you're killing me with it.
Of course not. Oh, did I mention, too, that you should have one creature in here that I think we never talked about?
Oh, what's that?
The Prophet of Krufix.
Yes, we've never talked about the Prophet of Krufix before.
Yeah, never. But you should probably play her in this deck because, you know, she's in the colors.
Yeah, that's the thing. She has nothing to do with what this deck's trying to do. It doesn't
Absolutely
matter.
Nothing. Doesn't matter, yeah.
Doesn't matter. She's still awesome in this deck. I guess she sort of gives your guys, like, virtual haste. Because, like,
right,
let's say
you
have, what's the other infect guy, the Spine Biter? So let's say you have Spine Biter. Well, if you played him on your turn, everyone would have a chance to kill him by the time your turn rolls around again. But if you played mm-hmm. on the end step of your opponent's turn right before your turn, now they only have that instant to kill it before it's killing them.
Yep.
So
pretty great.
Yeah, and plus she just gives you access to all your mana all the time for counters and protecting your creep. Nah, God, she's just awesome. Yep, Prophet of Crew Fix, everybody. You heard it here for the 50th time.
You've never heard it before. You've doubted her effectiveness before, but guys, we promise, she's better than you expect. No, she's
has anybody actually doubted her? I've never heard a single naysayer. Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay,
exactly.
So we're preaching to the choir.
Yep, exactly. Definitely, just buy some. Just hold on to them. Why not? I mean, yeah, anytime you make a green-blue deck, you're going to put her in there.
I really want one of those cool foil alternate art ones.
I think they're only $2 right now. So you
the alternate art ones are only $2?
Yeah, I'm pretty sure, yeah. Oh. You check it out.
Okay, I'm going to get some.
And until a company sponsors us, we will not tell you where to find these cards. You just have to do it yourself.
I'm sure you can figure it out, peeps.
Yeah, it's not too hard. It's the worldwide internet.
All right, so that's going to wrap up this episode. Thanks, everybody, for listening. Thanks, everybody, for feedback we've been receiving on Twitter and over email. You know, we love that. We're always looking for new commanders to spotlight, so go ahead and tweet at us or email us, you know, who you want to hear us talk about.
Yeah, definitely. And if you guys have any other of your own personal rules or teaching, or if you are a teacher and found certain things to be effective, please email that in, and we can definitely discuss them in future episodes because we value your input.
Or put it in the comments. You know, anybody who's watching or listening to this episode, you know, can glance down in the comments and see some other good philosophies for teaching Magic to new players.
Yeah, we'd love to start a discussion. So, yeah, please help us out.
All right, cool. So with that, we will say peace out.
Peace out to the world. See you guys next time.
Later.
Thank you for your attention. For further inquiries, send an email to commandcast@rocketjump.com or ask us on Twitter @JFWong and @JoshLeeKwai. See you later, alligator.
Greetings, humans.